The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome everybody on this beautiful afternoon to All Saints. Some of us have spent more or less of the day together at various points. Some of us are just gathered together now. Some of us are gathered at home and watching the live stream. Wherever you've come from, whatever you've spent this day doing, you're very welcome in the name of Christ. We have had an eventful day, not quite field and fountain, moor and mountain, but close. We've enjoyed some of us walking from Barrow down to Flax, along to Keedwell, and now here we end our pilgrimage as we began it, in the presence of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so, as we begin our worship together, we're going to light three candles and renew our awareness of God with us. And so we light this light in the name of the Father who fosters all.
Amen.
We light this light in the name of the Saviour who embraces all. And we light this light in the name of the Spirit who encircles all. Amen. We pray with thanksgiving for this day that has passed. Thanks be to you, O Christ, for the many gifts you have bestowed on us. Each day and night, each sea and land, each weather fair, each calm, each wild. Each night we remember your mercy given so gently and generously. Each thing we have received, from you it came. Each thing for which we hope, from your love it will come. Each thing we enjoy, it is of your bounty. Each thing we ask comes of your disposing. O God, from whom each thing that is freely flows, grant that no tie over strict, no tie over dear, may be between ourselves and this world. Amen. And so we hear our first hymn, a hymn of praise for creation, and maybe you'd like to hum quietly behind your mask, because this is one you really want to join in with.
Oh,
And so we say together Psalm 121, responsively, beginning on my side with verse 1 and then Richard's side for verse 2 and the even verses. I lift up my eyes to the hills, from where will my help come? He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. Amen. Here are first reading from the Old Testament.
This entire commandment that I command you today, you must diligently observe, so that you may live and increase and go in and occupy the land that the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember the long way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, in order to humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commandments. He humbled you by letting you hunger, then by feeding you with manna, with which neither you nor your ancestors were acquainted, in order to make you understand that one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. The clothes on your back did not wear out, and your feet did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a parent disciplines a child, so your God disciplines you. Therefore, keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with flowing streams, with springs and underground waters, welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land where you may eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and from whose hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you.
The choir are going to sing for us now an anthem, Let All Creation Sing.
Thank you. Whoever has the Son has life.
Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the boldness we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have obtained the requests made of him.
I speak in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord your God is bringing you into a good land. We've seen a bit of that today on our travels around this area, this piece of good land. We've seen the beauty, the goodness, the abundance of this place, this land which the Lord our God has given us, in which, for whatever reason and for however long now, he has seen fit to have us live and work and worship. I well remember just over a year ago standing somewhere around here where I was reminded at my licensing that I was coming to a land of milk and honey and was presented with tokens of the same, which we very much enjoyed. Those verses from Deuteronomy could have been written about this place, maybe not quite the olive trees, although there's probably one or two around. But it could have been written about this place as much as about the promised land. And in one sense, of course, they are written about this land and about every piece of land. Because as much as they describe a specific geographical location to which the people of God were being led at that point, they are also describing, in a universal sense, the relationship, the covenant that God has made with his creation as a whole. And that covenant, as the writer goes on to explain, is confirmed in every generation. A covenant which balances on the one hand God's abundant goodness to his creation, the dignity afforded to humankind, and on the other, a proper sense of humility on our part, an acknowledgement of our very significant responsibilities as the human race corporately as a result. Humility and responsibility are part of the deal. As Richard reminded us this morning, humility reminds us that we are without doubt the stuff of the earth, made of dust and returning to dust. But we're reminded also in Psalms and elsewhere that God has made us a little lower than the angels, has crowned us out of all creation, and given us a special relationship within touching distance of God, in which everything we need is provided, but in which we also have a very special role. This entire commandment that I command you today, you must diligently observe, so that you may live and increase. Our relationship, our covenant with God requires humility, that we recognize our dependence and acknowledge our provision, but that we also take hold of our responsibility, our rightful, wonderful place in the order of creation, and do our bit to care for it, to carry out the job God gave us as stewards. So far, so straightforward, perhaps, obey the command, live and increase. Sounds simple, except that it's not, is it? As we look around our world, we see so many examples not of life and of increase, but of death and diminishing, starvation, pollution, inequality, the life-changing impact of climate change, need of every kind. And here we need to pause for a moment to clarify a couple of things, because from what I've said so far, it might be easy to fall into the trap of thinking in terms of a prosperity gospel. A gospel that says God rewards with his favor and provision those who are faithful. And if you don't appear to enjoy that favor, the message goes, maybe you don't have enough faith, or you're hiding away too much unconfessed sin. You must try harder. But I don't think it takes a rocket scientist to look at those most in need in our world to work out that lack of faith is not necessarily the problem. In fact, it seems to me that the people suffering most from pollution and injustice and poverty in our world are far from faithless. In fact, it may only be their faith that enables them to hold body and soul together in the face of unspeakable hardship. So when faithful people still suffer need, and we still find examples everywhere of those who are over-provided, storing up mountains of produce they can't consume, nations which look after themselves first, plundering or polluting the resources of others in the process, it seems that there must be something else going on, an extra dimension to this covenant. I learned a new word recently from an African language called Shona, which I gather is spoken in Zimbabwe, another country which knows a thing or two about the unequal distribution of resources. The word is ukama, U-K-A-M-A, and it describes, so I read, a way of being and living which is perfectly in harmony, not only with our neighbours, but also with nature, with creation, a way of living which gives the lie to the idea that the individual self is king, but that each of us as individuals find our true worth and identity in community with others and the land from which we were made. The people of Israel were treated as a whole group in the Old Testament, and the Hebrew word shalom has much in common with this Shona term ukama. It describes that covenant living which is characterized by interdependence, respect for the other, respect for the land. And it says that when we damage those relationships of interdependence, then we ourselves are also diminished, not to mention our neighbors and the land. The kingdom of God looks like humankind in its entirety, remembering its place before its creator and living out its responsibilities to one another and blessing the land in which it lives. We as human beings affect one another by the way we live, and we affect the progress of the redemption of the earth, the advance of the kingdom of God, by the choices we make about the wealth and provision we have. And so some words to end with, which to my shame I can't attribute to anyone, I'm afraid, but I offer them to you anyway. Whatever you do, live humbly as stewards of all that has been given to you. Use whatever you've been given for God's glory and for the coming of his kingdom to bless the lives of others. By giving away your life in myriad small ways, then will you know the joy of finding true life, the life that secures the future in a good land, the best land, where you will eat your fill forever. Amen.
We come to our prayers of concern. And the response to the words, Lord, hear us, is Lord, graciously hear us. Let us pray to Christ, who shelters all life under the open arms of the cross. Christ, the Word, who spoke creation into existence, send your blessing upon the rich earth. Let the land be fruitful and its resources hallowed. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus, son of Joseph the carpenter, send your blessing upon human labor. Prosper the work of our hands. May all find dignity and just reward in their work. Free the exploited and the oppressed. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord of the harvest, send your blessing upon the produce of the earth. Guide us into a sustainable future and give us the will to share the fruits of the world. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus, Master, who the wind and waves obeyed, send your blessing upon the seas and waters. Teach us to cherish the water of the earth and to conserve the seas, lakes, and rivers. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Compassionate Christ, send your blessing upon aid agencies. Where the earth is parched and the well run dry, where war brings want and children go hungry, where the poor cry out for bread and for justice, give hands to care and heal. Compel us to be generous. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Healing, Lord, send your blessing on all who are affected by coronavirus through illness or isolation or anxiety. that they may find relief and recovery. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Christ, the servant King, send your blessing on all who are guiding our nation at this time and shaping national policies, remembering especially all those at the G7 conference taking place about now in Carbis Bay in Cornwall. May they make wise decisions for the common good. Lord, hear us.
Graciously hear us.
Loving Lord Jesus, send your blessing upon the vulnerable and the fearful, the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your comfort and peace.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We are placing our souls and bodies unto your guarding this light, O Christ. O Son of the tears, of the wounds, of the piercings, may your cross this night be shielding all.
I invite you to stand if you're able. And as we prepare to go from this place out into the land which gave us life and the land to which we will return, maybe you'd like to turn and look through a window or a door out into the world as you receive God's blessing as we pray together. Be the great God between your shoulders to protect you in your going and your coming. Be the Son of Mary near your heart, and be the perfect Spirit upon you pouring. Amen.